Hadvit Pharma welcomes you to the ocean of practical knowledge about small animal practice, that is Hadvit's YouTube channel. We are thankful to Dr. Vinod Kumar for sharing his practical tips with fellow veterinarians.
Now let us have an interaction of the skin and a comparison of the human skin and the canine skin. The canine skin comprises 5 layers. As we all know, we have lot of skin glands, like we have the sweat glands, sebaceous glands, hormonal glands, pheromonal glands, other glands which produce too much of oil, certain glands which secretes produces cholesterol, certain other glands which produces lot of other chemicals which are involved in inflammatory processes. The most important are the sebaceous glands and the sweat glands. And coming to the sweat glands and sebaceous glands. See, the sweat glands are actually for the control of body heat or the dissipation of body heat, by which we sweat a lot to dissipate our body heat. When there is increase in body heat, as when there is a fever. For example, we know the stages of fever. We have the stage of crisis, we have the stage of lysis, we have the stage of defervescence. During the stage of defervescence, we know what will happen. The temperature abruptly decreases. In the stage of crisis, it will increase and sweating happens. So, whenever there is an increase in body temperature, the body will try to bring down the temperature by giving out or flowing out so much of water through sweat. That means there is a role of the skin on heat dissipation. Okay, so these sweat glands are very less in number. We should say 1 in 20, 1 in 30 or so. That means if there are 30 sweat glands on dog, a human skin, comparison to with the dog skin, there will be only 1 sweat gland. Got it? On a particular area of skin, if it is on the human skin, suppose I say there are 20 sweat glands. When compared to the dog, there will only be 1 sweat gland. That is why we say that the dog will not sweat. And sweat glands are mostly concentrated in the interdigital spaces as well as the muzzle. That is why when there is excess heat, the interdigital space becomes wet and chance of interdigital pyoderma is more in hot conditions. Got it? That is how we substantiate. And also when there is increased temperature, ambient temperature, there is excess sweating of the muzzle of the dog. It doesn't mean that all other parts of the skin doesn't have the sweat gland at all. Yes, it has. But it is concentrated on the muzzle as well as the interdigital space skin. Got it? And another important thing is that the skin of the dog, the canine skin, is alkaline in nature, whereas the human skin is acidic in nature. You know where it is. Acidic nature means naturally the pH should be lower than 7, and alkaline nature means the pH should naturally be above 7. But you cannot see a pH of above 7.8 or 7.98, etc., on the skin. That is corrosive, because it produces corrosiveness. Yes, the same thing also happens when the pH lowers. When the pH lowers, it cannot go beyond, it cannot come down beyond a certain limit. We cannot pour hydrochloric acid onto the skin. We cannot pour sulfuric acid onto the skin to reverse the skin pH. So got it. See, generally, the skin of the human beings is slightly acidic and the skin of the dog is slightly alkaline. This is the major difference between the skin of dogs and human beings. That is why it is clearly mentioned No human shambles should be used on the dog. Sometimes we have seen that some clients are using Head and Shoulders shampoo on the dog. And they happen to see that all the fur is fallen off. Deep pilation, we say. It's quite natural because we are actually reversing the pH. We are actually reversing the normal pH. The normal pH was alkaline, and the dog's shampoo was suited for the alkaline pH. Unfortunately, the client used human Head and Shoulders shampoo. It is a shampoo which is suited for the acidic pH. So what happened? The integrity of the whole epithelium will be lost. There will be epithelial denudation. The homeostatic mechanism, etc., will be lost. And so what will happen? The follicles will become loose. And the when the follicles become loose, easily the hair will be fallen off. And so that we say as depilation. Charge recovery. Depilation. And so that is the main difference which we have to take into account. So all the medications, all the shampoos, all the topical antibiotics, everything are dependent upon this pH. That is why we say the humans, they have the mupirocin ointment. Dogs, they have the mupirocin ointment. But better use the dog's mupirocin ointment. Of course, we have the human antibiotic other ointments. Better not to use on the dog skin because it is suited for the acidic skin. Okay, but it is better not to use a human antibiotic ointment or a shampoo or any other medication or any bath. Soap. Never use a human soap for the dog. This is also dependent upon the change in pH. I have seen that people using hammam soap, Lifebuoy soap, Medimix soap, all these soaps, all the human soaps are rich with phenol. Why? We know phenol is highly, terribly active in acidic pH. It is highly active in acidic pH. That is why it is active on the human skin. But the human's dog skin is slightly alkaline. If it goes to the alkaline side, it becomes corrosive. And so it is an irritant to the dog skin. So none of the phenolic soap should be used. Got it? That is why we always say never use a human soap for the dog. Especially, you know, these very, very dangerous soaps. This hammam soap, Medimix soap, Rathaas soap, then this Lifebuoy soap. All this contains lot of phenol in it. Better we should not use it. Sebaceous glands are less than in humans. So what happens? Sebaceous glands are less in than in humans. When compared to the human skin, sebaceous glands are less in number. So what happens? Sebaceous glands produces a cholesterol derivative. We say it is an oil. This oil will moisturize the skin, give an oily sheen to the skin. So what will happen to the dog skin? The sebaceous glands are very less. The production of sebum itself will be very less. The sebum cannot moisturize the topical skin. So what will happen? There is a tendency of the skin always to become dry. What happens to human skin? Human skin, according to the ambient temperature and according to the nature of the skin, they produce more oil. My skin is more oily. Some people have skin which is very dry. That depends upon the nature. Some genetic factor also is behind it. So, but the dog's condition is so pathetic. It has only very little number of sebaceous glands on the skin. So what will happen? Naturally, the tendency of becoming dry will be more on the dog's skin. So what will happen? So that is why we always advise our pet owners not to give bath all the time. We take bath. I take bath twice a day. But if a dog is bathed twice a day, means definitely all the skin will be eroded, all the fur will be lost. It will become a dog devoid of fur. That is why we say bath should be given in the dog only once in a week. That too according to the coat length, the fur length. As we all know, dogs, they according to their hair coats, they can be divided into short-haired breeds, medium-haired breeds, long-haired breeds. Like we have the Dalmatian, Dachshund, Rottweiler, Labrador, etc. are short-haired breeds. We have the German Shepherd. Then we have the wire-haired Dachshund. All these are the medium-haired breeds. We have the Pekingese. We have the Shih Tzu. We have the Afghan Hound. These are long-haired breeds. So in long-haired breeds, bath should be given only once in a month. In medium-haired breeds, only once in a fortnight, that means 2 weeks. In short-haired breeds, bath should be given only once in a week. And never in a breed less than a week gap. Why? It is because of the less number of sebaceous glands. Got it? Sweat glands are also less. So I have narrated sweat is needed essentially for the dissipation of heat. So if what happens if less number of sweat glands are there? Dissipation of heat becomes very difficult. That is why when we see that when the dog is let to run, it will run around, come back, gasping like this. Why? There is no other method of heat dissipation. There is no sweating in the dog. Only sweating is on the muzzle as well as individual face. So what will happen? Heat cannot go out through the natural mechanism of sweating. So what will happen? The dog has to find its own way to dissipate the heat. For that, what the dog, poor dog can do? It is only heat dissipation through evaporation. Panting. Evaporation from the trachea. That is tracheal evaporation. My next class is fluid therapy. I will come to fluid therapy and I will tell you about how much of fluid and water is being evaporated from the trachea while panting. All these things, it should be gone in deep. So, heat dissipation is done through panting. Excessive panting. Thereby, excess heat in the body will be dissipated. Okay. Then, according to that, skin is more delicate than in the humans. As we say, the dog is having a thick skin, but it is more delicate. Why it is delicate? Because all the natural mechanisms such as a sebum, the sweat, the hormones, etc. are very low in number as when compared to the human skin. And so it is termed that the human skin, the dog skin is delicate. So, as we all know, the skin has a very less role on heat dissipation. We have already mentioned it. And now, I'm going to the next slide. That is, we need not go deep into this picture. Just understand that there are five layers. The topmost layer, the black layer, is a keratinized layer. Why there is a keratinized layer? This keratinized layer contains dead epithelial cells. Dead cells. Actually, this is being kept there by the guard as an essential mechanism for protecting the skin against physical barriers such as rays, harmful rays from the external sources, especially the sun. We know the sun rays are rich in ultraviolet rays. Other cosmic rays are there, X-rays, gamma rays, all these are there which are harmful to the skin, especially the ultraviolet rays. The skin has to be protected against ultraviolet rays. So to a maximum, the skin. So why are we using an umbrella during sunshine? Why the umbrella is not white in color? People are using white umbrellas which is matching to their sari. That is another thing. But umbrella, the traditional umbrella was our old traditional umbrella was having that black cloth only. Umbrella should have a black cloth only. Why? This should come The rays should come and this rays should be absorbed by the surface and it should not penetrate the surface. That is why we are using the black umbrella. Like that, we should have a black skin. We should have a black skin. Why? To protect our skin from ultraviolet rays. So how there is a black skin? Naturally, people are there with black complexion, dark complexion, fair complexion, etc. You see, according to the color of the skin, we cannot say it is the color of the skin is white, color of the skin is black. No, it's not the color of the skin. It's a complexion of the skin. The complexion is fair, the complexion is dark. So, dark skin means, dark complexion skin means it has more amount of melanin pigment. As we all know, the melanin pigment is the pigment which is giving dark color to the skin. So, the skin, as I said, there are five layers, and the outermost layer is the stratum corneum, which contains cornified cells. Cornified cells are, again, they are not true live cells. They do not have a nucleus. And these cornified cells have an exclusive layer at the top, which contains melanin pigment. That is known as a cuticular layer. And melanin pigment is being deposited in between this cuticular layer and the stratum corneum. Okay? So that the melanin is black in color and the melanin will prevent ultrasound rays from entering the skin. So it is a physical barrier. Got it? So then comes the stratum corneum, which is again to protect the skin. Then the stratum lucidum, stratum granulosum, spinosum, and at last the stratum basale. The stratum basale is elongated columnar-like cells, and from these cells, the squamous cells of the skin are being generated. Okay, these were the five layers of the skin. Let us go to the next slide. Physical examination of the skin. How will you do a physical examination of the skin? It is very easy. Isn't it, sir? I always say, for a physical examination, you go near the animal, you examine the skin, and you see how far the skin is being mutilated. How will you go near the animal, which is a very terrific, terrible, biting Rottweiler? I always say to my juniors, eye is the main tool of a dermatologist. So examine the skin carefully with the naked eye first. Never examine a dog in feeble light, or never examine a dog on semi-light conditions. Never examine a dog under yellow light. All these things should be kept in mind. Always examine the skin of the dog under white light, powerful white light. Okay?
Hatred Pharma presents Clindahat Range. Clindahat syrup and tablets. Lincosamide antibiotic systemic drug. A weapon to fight deadly infection with care. Clindahat tablets. Clindamycin 250 mg tablets. Clindamycin 600 mg tablets. Clindahat syrup. Clindamycin 25 mg per ml. Indications: skin infections, dental, osteomyelitis, and protozoal infections including toxoplasmosis. Dosage for dogs: 5.5 mg to 33 mg per kg every 12 hours. For cats: 11 mg to 33 mg per kg once a day. Root: oral. Presentation: 1 into 10 tablets, 60 ml. You can book your order online at www.hatred.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
So, powerful white light only. So, eye is the main tool of examination. So, examine the skin very carefully. Do the lab tests only to confirm certain doubts. See, straight away when you see the skin, don't go and scrape it. It is absurd. Don't go and scrape it. Don't take a piece of venti-shaped mass for the histopathological examination. Don't do such absurd things. Our eye is there. It is a main tool. Our eye gives a lot of information. So what we should do? Carefully examine the eye. It is possible. Out of my 25 years of experience, I say it's possible always. It's always possible. So, examine the skin very carefully. Do the lab test only to confirm. Suppose Dr. Ravinder Sahab, now he is in here, Dr. Ravinder from Chandigarh, he is examining the doubt. He is having a doubt. Oh, I do believe that it has Demodex. Okay, he has a belief and he has a doubt. For clearing that doubt, he can take a scrape. Okay. Yesterday in my webinar, if our doctors who has attended my yesterday's webinar might have understood very clearly all these things. So, just do lab tests only to confirm certain doubts. See, all of a sudden, if you go and examine a mutilated skin, you may see Demodex scannings, you may see fungal spores, you may see yeast organisms. See, together when you find all these things on the skin, can you say that it is a conjoined problem due to Demodex scannings, fungus and yeast? No. The problem, the underlying problem might be that it is having a hypothyroidism. You are missing it. So, a careful examination is very important. So, the physical examination always should be preceded by a thorough anamnesis. What is anamnesis? The thorough history taking. So, always do laboratory tests only to confirm certain doubts. Okay? Then, whenever you have a difficulty in exercising or clearly understanding the peculiarities of the skin, okay, our eyes. See, I am 50 years old. I am not having a good visibility as a 25 years old boy or a girl. Yes, definitely. You can use a hand lens. But we should use a hand lens. Even 25 years old dermatologists use a hand lens. We should always magnify the skin and examine. We have to see whether the follicles are enlarged, follicles are engorged, the hair roots, the fur roots are inflamed and engorged, the pores are blocked. All these things can be seen while magnifying and seeing it. That is very important. Use a hand lens to view the skin surface as well. Use a white light torch or a headlamp to illuminate the skin surface. Never examine the skin in feeble light. That's what I have mentioned. When you are examining, either with one hand you can hold and you can use this torch for examining. But with the torch and lens, how can we do all these things? See, I have my own equipment. Everybody has. Our headset is there. Keep it on the head. It has the powerful view. It has a powerful white light. And it has the lens also. With that, we can simply hold the patient and simply examine like this. It's so easy. It's not as a dermatoscope. You can use it. Then another thing is that use daylight as far as possible. It is not possible all the time. Why? Because our patient sometimes may be brought during the night time. We cannot say, no, you go and come back during the next morning. What will happen? He will go back and he will never come back to your private hospital. So to avoid that, I cannot insist anybody to send back those patients since it is night time. Got it? So as far as possible, that is why I put the clause, as far as possible, use daylight. But it doesn't mean that you take out the animal outside the sunlight and examine under the sunlight. No. It should be only a reflected sunlight. It should not be direct sunlight. It should be a reflected sunlight. Better, our clinics are now not working under sunlight. We are all inside air conditioned hospitals. And so, we have our own dermatoscopes. Then, another thing, the next thing is so important. Go near the animal and examine from very near as 1 foot away. But beware of biting dogs. So, that is so amazing. go near the animal, keep your eye as near as 1 foot away and examine carefully. So doctors, my dear junior doctors, while I'm talking to you, there are 310 doctors here in this group. My junior doctors, from tomorrow onwards, don't go near a biting Rottweiler. Don't go near a biting Bull Mastiff. Just 1 foot away and examine, your eye and face will be lost. From the very next day, nobody will look at your face, beautiful face. You will lose your beautiful face, but better not to do it. So, how can you make it practical that this animal can be examined as near as 1 foot away? It's also possible. One, you can keep him inside the cage. You can go near him and examine. Or if you have a squeeze cage, you can put him inside the cage. You can squeeze him, make him immobile, and then you can examine. Or if you have a barrier like a glass, keep him on the other side of the glass, and from this glass near him, you can examine the skin. Or if the client is well, good enough to hold him and keep him properly, secure him properly, then that's good. You can, well, with the confidence, you can go near him, you can examine, and you can find out what the lesion is. Okay? That was regarding some tips on clinical examination. Now, whenever you see a skin lesion, never be prejudiced. And this, why I've put this sentence, because I've seen a lot of our friends becoming prejudiced. When there is a skin lesion all over the body, immediately from a distance itself, they will become prejudiced and they will say that, oh, it is fungal infection. Immediately from the distance itself, they will write the course of ketoconazole. No, never become prejudiced. I can say, I am sure that without a thorough clinical examination, nobody in this 312 group can diagnose without a thorough clinical examination. Yes. So no prejudice. Don't go with the prejudiced mind. Don't approach the patient with a prejudiced mind or with a symptom of a lesion. It may mislead or misguide you. That happens very, very commonly. It happens. Don't become prejudiced. Then, one important thing is that what the human dermatologists also do, study the basic lesion, whether you have the pustule or the papule or the vesicle or the excoriation or the ulcer, whatever it be. And if needed, means you can note it on a piece of paper, 20% pustules, 30% folliculitis, 20% papules, 10% vesicles, 1% excoriation. Like that, you can note it down. So, see, immediately after that, the diagnosis will come. Okay. So, if you need, you can note it down. So, study the basic lesions that are fundamental to reach a conclusive diagnosis. Okay. Then, if needed, of if possible. Okay, seniors like us, seniors like me, or Ravinder ji, or Amarnath, doesn't need it to be written down. I know that our hero Amarnath is watching. So, it is not needed. But for juniors, it's always better to note down the lesion. See, for that, we have to know what type of lesion it is. What a pustule is, what a papule is, what a vesicle is, what an excoriation is, what an ulcer is, we should know. Okay? Then, note down all the lesions first and then correlate this with the clinical sign. What is the clinical sign? The dog is having pruritus. It doesn't have pruritus, it has pruritus. Okay, that is a clinical sign. Sometimes it is having hyperpigmentation. It is having no hair, no fur on the body. Okay, that is good. But you are on the way to conclude that it is hypothyroidism. So it is fungal dermatitis. Now suddenly the client will say that, doctor, I forgot to tell you one thing, doctor. Yes, what's it? It always, whenever it is let free, it will go to the sunshine and it will lay on the sunshine only. It will not come to a shade. It needs always sunlight. Okay, so there comes the clue. The most crucial clue is coming. That is, it is a heat-seeking dog. It's a clear symptom of hypothyroidism. Got it? So always correlate the lesions with the clinical signs. And do a systemic relevant examination in need to rule out the secondary diseases. I stress the point, systemic relevant clinical examination. If the dog is having a skin lesion, you are going to palpate the stifled joint of the dog. What is the use? Irrelevant examination. So go for relevant examination. I have seen some people who are examining the dog for the sake of showing the client that he is doing something. Am I right or not? I am right. So, do systemic clinical examination, relevant examination related to rule out the secondary diseases. For example, you are examining the dog with complete, almost 80% hyperpigmentation. Dog is having severe pruritus, and the pruritus is due to an internal irritant. And the dog has excoriations, Demodex positive, and this dog is having splenomegaly. What will you suspect? Definitely, if it is splenomegaly, we can suspect that it could be an immunological disorder. So it could be pemphigus vulgaris, it could be pemphigus foliaceus, it could be a bullous pemphigus, or it could be a systemic lupus erythematosus. We do not know. Only after thorough clinical examination and only after coming through all the vital organ tests, we could know it. Got it? And mostly, never think of the skin alone, but maybe related to other systems. For example, why I'm telling this, never think of the skin alone. Sometimes, the skin may be having the disease. Always keep in mind that pathological problems of the skin is a reflection of the internal disease. It's a reflection of the internal disease. That is why I always stress to the point that 60% of the dogs with dermatopathies brought to our clinic could be secondary dermatopathies. Got it? So, we have to think of it. That is why I say, never think of the skin alone in dogs. When you see a dermatopathy in a dog, always go for a thorough clinical examination. So, you may be able to pick out some related other clinical symptoms or findings. For example, when the skin is presented to you, dog is presented to you, a 4-year-old Labrador is presented to you, it is having skin disease, they say. Directly you are going to, you think that the skin is having the problem, you are directly going to examine the skin and you see so many things on the skin. But the real things are hidden there. If you would have asked the client, the client would have narrated that it is having increased water consumption. That is, it has polydipsia. He might have told that it has polyphagia. It has polyuria. Okay. It has edema of the hind limbs. It has a puffy face. So you are not getting, you are not considering all these clinical signs. You are just, your eyes are so narrow and you think about the skin only. And you may miss the disease. It could be Cushing syndrome, but you missed it. Okay, that is why never think that the skin of the dogs alone, related other clinical symptoms, has to be ruled out by a thorough clinical examination. Another thing is that don't overlook a single lesion. Sometimes you may be seeing, you may be thinking that those are irrelevant lesions. Why should I think badly about it? Why is it leave it? Those no. Each and every single and a simple lesion may be seen highly significant. Don't leave a single lesion which may be significant. That is very important. Okay? I'm going to the next slide. Let us see what are the different lesions which are generally being seen on the dark skin. Lesions on the skin are primarily classified into four. Primary lesions, secondary lesions, tertiary lesions, and specific or special lesions. Now let us go to each and each part. Primary lesion. Primary lesion means the insult has occurred on the skin and some symptoms might have developed or reaction of the skin suddenly to the noxious or the pathological stimulus. Suppose a bacteria is attacking the skin. Immediately, the skin will respond, producing certain small abscesses. We say as papules. So, these are the primary lesions. Papules, pustules, vesicles, bile, folliculitis, furuncles, carbuncles, impetigos, and bullae. Let us take each and each of these. Number one, the primary lesions, number one. What is a papule? Papule, what is a papule? Of course, all the doctors sitting here very well know what a papule is. A papule is nothing but it is papules. All these things are very superficial. Papules, pustules, vesicles, bile, folliculitis, furuncles, carbuncles, impetigo and bullae. All these are superficial ones. Learn through it, it is all superficial ones. So these primary lesions are papules. So papules are those primary skin eruptions which are found bouncing on the skin, which is enlarging outside, which is bumping outside, which contains pus. So if the papule is very big, we can say it's an abscess. It's a cutaneous abscess. Here it is not an abscess. It's a very small bump of the epithelial skin bulging out, which contains little bit of pus inside. And that too, if the diameter of that eruption is less than 3 millimeters, we call it as a papule. Got it? It's a papule. So presence of papule. When papules occur, it contains pus. When pus occurs, if there is a bacterial disease. See, in viral disease, there is no papule. Just 1 minute. Yeah. So are you able to see this? Admin, are you able to see this? Are you able to hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Now, papules. Papules are skin eruptions which contain pus, which is below 3 millimeters in diameter. So, quite naturally, see, generally we should say according to the lesion, things differ. For example, hemorrhages on the skin. Which is the smallest hemorrhage on the skin? Petechial hemorrhage. If it's a little bit larger, we say it's a purpural hemorrhage. Again, it is, if it is large means, if it is large means.
Hatred Pharma launches Hatclav 250 syrup and Hatclav 500 tablets. Amoxicillin and clovenic acid in the ratio 4:1, which is required for our pets. Hatclav. Potentiated amino penicillin systemic drug. Amoxicillin plus potassium clovenate. Bactericidal amino penicillin with beta-lactamase inhibitor with extended spectrum of antibacterial activity. Amoxicillin and potassium chlorinate oral suspension had CLAV 250 suspension. Amoxicillin 200 mg plus potassium chlorinate 50 mg per 5 ml. Indications: broad spectrum antibiotic for bacterial infections, skin, soft tissue, and UTI infections. Dosage for dogs: 13.75 mg per kg every 12 hours. For cats: 62.5 mg per cat every 12 hours. Route: oral. Presentation: 30 ml. Amoxicillin and potassium chlorinate tablets had CLAV 500 tablets. Amoxicillin 400 mg plus potassium chlorinate 100 mg. Indications: broad spectrum antibiotic for bacterial infections, skin, soft tissue, and UTI infections. Dosage for dogs: 13.75 mg per kg every 12 hours. For cats: 62.5 mg per cat every 12 hours. Route: oral. Presentation: 1 into 10 tablets. You can book your order online at www.hatred.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
Petechial hemorrhage, that becomes a petechial hemorrhage. When it is a little bit large, it becomes ecchymotic hemorrhage. Ecchymotic hemorrhage, still it is large, means it's a purpural hemorrhage. Still it is large means it is extravasations. Still again large means the largest one is a hematoma. Okay. So like this, if it is a very small pus containing eruption, we say it's a papule, the smallest one. Just above that, if it is above 3 millimeters, we say it is a coin, it's a pustule. If it's above 3 millimeters, it's a pustule. And one which is larger is known as an abscess. Got it? So pustules, papules. So papules are less than 3 millimeters in diameter. And pustules are those pus containing eruptions on the superficial layer of the skin, which is above 3 millimeters in diameter. Okay. Then the third one is vesicles. Coming to the vesicles. The vesicles are topical, or this doesn't contain any exudate, but it contains transudates. Vesicles contain transudates. That means it contains clear serous fluid inside. Vesicles are generally seen when there are blisters. For example, burnings, blisters due to heat. Blisters due to acids and alkalis. Blisters due to sunburn. Blisters due to viral infections. But viral topical infections, viral cutaneous infection in dog is extremely rare. For only a very few cases of herpes viral infection in dogs. That is only one. Or the variola viruses, pox viruses, etc. It is there, but it is extremely rare in the dog. So there are vesicle containing serous fluids. Then we have the boils. Boils are nothing but a cutaneous skin erythematous reaction, or a cutaneous inflammation, or a cutaneous superficial inflammation which is encircling a hair root, a fur root. But it is encircling the hair root, but the hair root or the hair follicle is not inflamed. Got it? So a boil is not painful. Got it? A boil is not painful because it is not involving the hair follicle. Only the lesions are confined to around the root of the hair or the fur. But in the folliculitis, the hair follicle itself will inflame and the hair follicle bulges out. It's a really painful condition. When there is a folliculitis, it's a painful condition. See, whenever we are handling these animals, we are not bothered about the pain of these animals. But when we get a folliculitis, we will come to know how painful it is. So it is a painful condition. So boils are not painful because it is not involving the hair follicle. But in the folliculitis, it is involving the hair follicle, and the follicle produces inflammation known as a folliculitis. So that is folliculitis, and a single follicle inflammation is known as a folliculitis. So if a larger number, hundreds of hair follicles are involved, we term it as a furuncle. So furuncles are conjoined follicles. Conjoined folliculitis, it is highly painful. And I've seen that in furuncles and carbuncles, dog becomes too defensive. Dogs may bite sometimes. So furuncle, they are conjoined folliculitis. More than one inflamed follicles will be conjoined and they form a large hair folliculitis. And so that is a furuncle, it is a painful one. Carbuncle means it's a severely inflamed, severely infected, a very big abscess formation. It's an enlarged furuncle where an abscess like thing might have formed. It is again which needs constant antibiotic therapy. Impetigo. Impetigo means, see, a pustule or a papule means there is only one or two pustule or papule on the skin surface. If it is a diffused form, if it is evenly distributed, it is known as impetigo. Impetigo means diffused papules or pustules. Then, another thing is bulle. Bulle means they are actually, bulle means they are actually big vesicles itself. I have already mentioned what a vesicle itself is. A vesicle means it is an eruption on the skin which contains a clear fluid, serous transudate inside. So that's a vesicle. And the wall of the vesicle will be very thin. If you simply press it, it will break up. So that is the vesicle. And a bulla means when it's a vesicular subset, vesicular eruption, it has this serous fluid inside, but the wall of the vesicle is so thick that naturally it will not rupture. Such a thing is a bulla. See, we have to clearly differentiate between a bulla and a vesicle, because vesicles are generally found when there is blisters. These are blisters only. But when bulla are seen, it's a clear indication that there is an immunogenic process going on. Got it? It could be an immune disease. So that's a bulla. It contains serous collection, but a thick wall. Now I think you have a clear idea of all these primary lesions. These are the primary lesions we have to look into. Okay? Next we are going to the secondary lesions. Secondary lesions means the primary lesion or the primary insult has come. It produces a primary lesions, and due to the primary lesions, some awkward things has happened on the surface of the skin. Due to the primary lesion, some lesions slowly has happened. It is known as a secondary lesion. This, see, when we come across with it, you will come to know. Number one, macules. Macules is not a primary lesion. Macules means they are circumscribed dark lesions slowly or suddenly occurring on the superficial skin, which generally is a classical sign that there is an endocrinological dysfunction. For example, if you circumscribed, see, there will be circumscribed, there will be circular, dark, black patches. These patches are known as macules. When one single such a patch is seen, it is known as a macule, And if it is distributed to more than one, such macules are known as maculae. Maculae, M-A-C-U-L-A-E. See, in your clinical practice, if you find macules or maculae on the skin, always be in an impression that it has some endocrinological dysfunction. Like, it could be a chronic biometra. If it is a female, it could be a chronic biometra. If it's a male, it could be a subdermal tumor. But fortunately or unfortunately, we know that there is no subdermal tumor in the female. There is no biometra in the male. Of course, there are some people who has diagnosed biometra in a four-year-old male. Has seen such a person. Even he has diagnosis from ultrasound also. It was a castrated male. I don't know how this happened. So that is regarding a macule. If you only see a macule, macule means they are circumscribed black patches, hyperpigmented patches on the skin, suddenly occurring or gradually occurring on the skin, which are classical to endocrinological disorders. For example, if you see a macule on a female, an aged female, it could be a biometra. See, I don't care. I don't say that it is always a biometra, but 99% of the cases will be biometra. But if a macule is on the top of the male, I cannot say it is a biometra. So, if it's a female, it could be a biometra. If it's a male, it could be a sertoli cell adenoma. So, you know what a sertoli cell tumor is. So that is what it is regarding macules, secondary lesions. You will have to go to the secondary lesion. Wheals or urticarial reactions. All the doctors might have seen these wheals, urticaria, always associated with allergic reactions. All the doctors might have exercised this problem. I myself has exercised it several times. Sometimes some doctors might have given intravenous injection of amoxicillin clavulanic acid. I always insist to my juniors never to give amoxicillin clavulanic acid intravenously, because almost 90% of the cases will show urticarial reactions and type 1 immune reaction. So, wheals, they are urticarial reactions. So in wheals, there will be eruptions on the skin which are highly pruritic in nature. Okay, and suddenly occurring. See, wheals will not occur much gradually. If at all it occurs suddenly. You are giving penicillin injection, you are giving ampicillin injection. Immediately after 10 minutes, it is developing wheals. All on a sudden, abruptly, ekdam marai. So such a reaction is a wheal. So wheal is an urticarial reaction. It is associated with allergic reactions. Okay, I will show you the picture of wheal also. Those who never had seen a wheal can see. We also might have experienced this wheal several times in this next. Dave, it will be highly pruritic. Khujli to badi kaafi hai. The patient will be scratching the body. You can see with wheals, your dog patient, the canine patient will be rubbing the face on the floor. It will be scratching all the face and the cheeks and all. It will be producing self-inflicted injuries with their claws. There is no nail on the dog. It's only claw. There is no fur on the dog. There is no hair on the dog. It's only fur. There is no finger for the dog. It's only digit. See, sometimes some people may say that my dog's right forefinger is damaged. There is no such a finger in the dog. It's only digit. And there is no hand for the dog. No, there is no hand. People may come with the dog and say, on the hand there is a lesion, on the leg there is a. See, it's only because we are upright. We have only hands and legs. In the dogs, it is the hind limbs and the forelimbs, not the hands and the legs. It has four legs, the hind legs and the four legs. Okay, so I'm deviating from the path. Anyway, that is wheels. Then nodules. Nodules are hard, small eruptions of the body which contain solid, inspissated dry pus. Inspissated means solidified. Solidified pus inside. See, that itself will prove that nodules are chronic in nature. So, if you find certain nodules on the body, you can assume that an ongoing bacterial inflammatory process might have happened some weeks or months before, and now it had pustules and papules during that time, and now the pustules and papules, they had pus, and the pus inside these pustules and papules, from these pus, all the fluid portion was reabsorbed, and only the exudate portion solidified, and this produced a nodule. So nodule shows the chronicity of the lesion. Got it? Then scales. Scales, crusts and flakes. These are brothers and sisters. These are brothers and sisters. Scales are large epithelial eruptions or erosions in nature, where these are very much dry in nature and this can be peeled off. For example, in the case of chronic scaly or crusty form of dermatitic mange, which I have mentioned yesterday, the crusty form of dermatitic mange, it's a chronic type of lesion where scales will develop. And so you work with, you know, the patient's honest fingers will be trembling like this to peel off all the crust, especially scales. So what will happen if scales are peeled off? Nothing will happen, but it will bleed with the raw ulcers popping out. So that is scales. It will be completely dried because all the water from the fluid from the scales will be absorbed by the skin, and only the superficial layer will be having that dry, denuded skin and other debris. That is scales. Crusts. I have said that scales, crusts and flakes are brothers and sisters. Crust means they are not such dried, but comparatively they are dried, but mostly they are moist in nature. They will have a moist appearance. I will show you the picture so that you can easily understand. So crusts are somewhat moist and loose. They are not so hard as a scale. Okay. Then the next one is for Samori. Okay, I will tell. The third one, the brothers and sisters of scales, crusts and flakes are brothers and sisters. Third is flakes. Flakes means they are very thin epithelial peelings. They are very thin epithelial peelings. Very thin epithelial peelings. Whenever you see flakes are very common in dogs, especially in young dogs. Due to biodermas, epithelial peeling or flakes are very common. It is very easy to identify that it is pyoderma in that dog. It's very easy. So that is flakes. I will show you. It contains leafy epithelium which are easily peeled off. And now we can go to seborrhea. Seborrhea means, of course, we all know, my dear doctor, seborrhea. It is nothing but the dandruff. Dandruff. So we have two types of dandruff. One is a dry dandruff. The other is oily dandruff. Dry dandruff, we should, you know, we are doctors. And we should perform only in a way that we are explaining everything in a strategic way of uttering technical terms. Okay, seborrhea. Seborrhea means two in nature. Seborrhea sicca and seborrhea oleosa. Seborrhea sicca means dry dandruff. You see, we should not say that it is a dandruff. We should say it is seborrhea. The layman, let him say it is a seborrhea. Okay, that's another thing. It is his headache. But we as doctors, we should say it's a seborrhea. Layman may say that it is a dry seborrhea, dry dandruff. But we should say it is a seborrhea sicca. Layman may say it's a oily dandruff. But we say It's a Seborrhea oleosa. And I should say Seborrhea sicca and Seborrhea oleosa. Seborrhea sicca is so classical to bacterial infections. And Seborrhea oleosa is classical to yeast infection on the skin. Got it? Always keep in mind, Seborrhea sicca is classical to bacterial infections, that is pyoderma, and Seborrhea oleosa is classical to chronic or acute yeast infections on the skin. Okay, then we are coming to epidermal flakes. We are coming to epidermal flakes. Epidermal chlorates. Epidermal chlorates means once an acute form of a pyoderma. Pyoderma means it is bacterial infection on skin. Pyoderma has occurred and there is a healing up because a natural body mechanism will heal up the skin pathological process. And so what will happen? There will be peeling up of the or peeling up and drying up of the topical layer of the epithelial layer of the skin. And so this topical epithelial layer, which can be seen at the rim of the lesion as dried and hanging cuticular layer. Dried and hanging cuticular layer, the epithelial layer itself can be seen. I will show you the picture, then you will come to understand what an epidermal collarette is. So, if you find epidermal collarette on a lesion, simply you should say that it is nothing but a bacterial infection. Epidermal collarette will never occur in a Seborrhea oleosa. Epidermal collarette will never occur in a dermatomyositis mange. Epidermal collarette will never occur in a dermatomycosis. But epidermal collarettes will be seen only on bacterial infections of the skin, that is pyoderma. So, from the secondary lesion itself, you could understand that it is a pyoderma. The etiological factor is a bacteria. So there is no. So that is why I said you should clearly use your. This is the our eye is the main tool. The main tool of the dermatology is the eye, nothing else. So clearly look through it and find out what actually has happened. So these were something regarding the secondary lesions. Now we'll go to the tertiary lesions. So tertiary lesions to develop will take. Let me drink one glass of water with your kind consent. Thank you. And now, tertiary lesion means we have the primary lesion, we have the secondary lesion, and due to all these lesions, now the skin has got too much of insult. And later on, maybe after 2 or 3 weeks, or sometimes after a month, tertiary lesions will develop. But tertiary lesions mostly are permanent in nature. For example, hyperpigmentation or dark color. Why there is hyperpigmentation? It's actually a reaction of the skin to an external violence. Like, for example, a chronic malassezia dermatitis. It is going on, the malassezia dermatitis is going on, the process is going on. All the epithelial topical superficial layer is being peeled off. Somehow the body has to protect the skin. For that, what the body can do? The body immediately will tell the pituitary, "Arre, my dear pituitary, arre, aap bhej dena, jaldi bhej dena, kya bhej dena?" What they will release? To release more amount of melatonin. So MSH, melanocyte stimulating hormone. So what the MSH will do? MSH will stimulate the melanocytes to secrete more amount of melanin pigment. So that, why this melanin pigment is being released in large quantities? Because the body, the homeostatic mechanism of the body itself can sense that the epithelial layer is gone. Skin is, it is raw. At any time, the ultraviolet rays can attack the body. So what happens? Immediately, large amount of melanin pigment will come. it will cover the whole skin. So on that area, we call it as a hyperpigmented skin. So that hyperpigmentation of that skin, what does it mean? There was an ongoing, diffused, not sometimes localized, ongoing process of severe reaction by which the superficial epithelial cells have denuded. And so, hyperpigmentation was essential. More number of pigments were essential in that area. So, hyperpigmentation occurs. But there is another thing known as lichenification. In lichenification, there will be, if the lichenification is the elder brother of hyperpigmentation. More than that, more than it has hyperpigmentation.
Hadvit Pharma launches its Hadpod range. Hadpod, Cefpodoxime 100 mg, 200 mg dispersible tablets, Cefpodoxime 100 mg per 5 ml oral suspension. The safe and effective choice for stubborn infections. Cefpodoxime Proxetil dispersible tablets, Hadpod 100 dt and Hadpod 200 dt tablets. Cefpodoxime oral suspension, Hadpod 100 ds. Cefpodoxime Proxetil 100 mg per 5 ml. Indications: Cefpodoxime is used in both dogs and cats to treat a variety of bacterial infections, including skin infections, wound infections, bone infections, pneumonia, and bladder infections. Dosage for dogs: 5 to 10 mg per kg, once daily for 5 to 7 days. For cats, 5 mg per kg, once every 12 hours, or 10 mg per kg once daily. Route: oral. Presentation: 1 into 10 tablets. For syrup, 30 ml. You can book your order online at www.hatwit.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
More than the number of pigments, the skin will become very thick and wrinkled. Skin will become very thick and wrinkled. I'll show you the picture. That is lichenification, or we say elephant skin. Dark, dry, thick, wrinkled skin. Then the third one is excoriation. Excoriation. X means away. Excoriation means the superficial layer itself has peeled off, exposing the deeper layers of the skin. Not the skin is gone, that's a wound. But this is excoriation, that means only the superficial two layers we have. We have five layers on the skin. The superficial two layers have gone. The cuticle or subcuticular layers and the stratum corneum is gone. Now the stratum lucidum is exposed to any insult. That is an excoriation. Then ulcers. Ulcers means the entire five skin layers are gone. There is a breach in continuity of the skin. There is a big gutter. There is a breach in continuity. And then again the normal skin starts. That is a breach in continuity, is known as an ulcer. Erythema. What is erythema? Everybody know erythema. Erythema is nothing but a hyperemia. Yesterday also I told about hyperemia. See, whenever there is an inflammation, we know which are the cardinal signs of inflammation. Rubor can have a tumor daughter punctuation. What is rubor? What is rubor? Whenever there is an insult, whenever there is inflammation, whenever there is an insult to a particular area, due to that insult, so there is an immune mechanism which is going on. And due to that immune mechanism, there will be toxins liberated. And these toxins, and immediately the homeostatic mechanism of the body will sense that there are toxins being released, and the toxins are being accumulated in this particular area where it has to be removed immediately. What the body can do immediately, the brain will, Mr. Blatt, you go there. You don't worry, you go there. I will dilate all the vessels there. You go there and have a very more supply there. so that you can absorb all the toxins inside and then dump it into the kidney through the, let it go through the urine. Got it? So that's a detoxification process. That is a hyperemic process. So that is a rubor. What is tumor? When there is an insult or inflammation, more water is being added to the interstitial space. Why? To dilute those toxins there. Toxins are being liberated into the interstitial space. And in order to dilute those toxins which are liberated, so too much of water is being poured into that area. Toxins are invariably diluted. But the more amount of water produces swelling of that area, we call it as a tumor. Rubor, tumor. What is calor? Calor is nothing but increased temperature. Why there is increased temperature? Whenever there is more supply, there is increased temperature. So it is quite natural. That is calor. What is dollar? Dollar means it is not the dollar surgery. It is not the US dollar. It is not the Canadian dollar. It is a pain. Dollar means pain, pain. So dollar has pain. Why there is pain? It's a body mechanism by which already it has an insult, and that area should be kept very safely. No movement, nobody should touch it to additionally demutilate the inflamed area. So pain should be there, evenly distributed there. That is a dollar. Functionalasia, no functions on that area at all. It is completely locked down. Completely locked down. Because severe inflammation, because the coronavirus has infected this place and it is completely infected and no functions has to happen. It has to nullify all the functions. For example, in paroviral enteritis, no food, it will be omitted out. No, nothing is being retained in the intestine, diarrhea occurs. So it is complete rest to the intestinal mucosa. So that is functional issue. So rubor, calor, tumor, dollar, functional issue. So erythema means it is hyperemia. It is rubor. Then another tertiary lesion is acanthosis nigricans. It is another, the eldest brother of hyperpigmentation. So one brother of hyperpigmentation, the youngest brother is hyperpigmentation. The elder brother is lichenification. And the eldest brother of hyperpigmentation is acanthosis nigricans, where we can see almost jet black skin. Almost jet black skin. Almost jet black skin. And you can see the comedones and the keratin tissue which is being bulged out. These are known as acanthus. Acanthus or the acanthus. These are horn-like things. And the lesion is known as acanthosis nigricans. Acanthosis nigricans is very commonly seen in chronic deep, chronic and highly, it's a chronic form, in chronic form and diffused form of hyperthyroidism. In hypothyroidism, if it is too much involved and the thyroxine level is too low, that it affects the complete integrity of the skin itself. This lesion is for acanthosis nigricans. Again, there is another thing. Pityriasis. Pityriasis is the father of acanthosis nigricans. Now you can see the youngest son is hyperpigmentation. The middle one, the younger one, the elder one is lichenification. The eldest one is acanthosis nigricans. And the father of acanthosis nigricans is pityriasis. And pityriasis means the skin is too hyperpigmented. Skin contains too much of comedones and acanthus. And skin is very thick also. That is pityriasis. And pityriasis occurs in certain immune diseases. If you see pityriasis, it could be, generally, it is not, pityriasis is normal in chronic lesions on the bony prominences. For example, in callus pyoderma. In chronic hyperpigmented calluses. For example, over the point of elbow. It is common. But otherwise, if on a flat skinned surface, pityriasis is found, it is abnormal. It could be the worst form of hyperthyroidism. It could be the worst form of chronic pyometra. It could be the very worst form of Sertoli-cell tumor. It could be a very worst for something. There could be an ovarian tumor inside. You have to find it out. Got it? So these were some of the tertiary lesions. And now we will go to specific lesions. There are four types of specific lesions we have. Specific lesions are very commonly found. I have seen all of these lesions. In annular lesions, it will be ring-shaped lesions. And these ring-shaped lesions, it will be correctly rounded. It will be completely red in color. Annular lesions are very commonly seen in pemphigus vulgaris, immune-mediated diseases. Pemphigus vulgaris is extremely common among dogs. I have seen it several times. Out of my 25 years of service, I have seen it several times. See, before, when I was working during 2001, 2002, etc., annular lesions were commonly seen in our practice, but we could not exactly coin what it was. Then, isoform lesion. Isoform lesions means they will be semicircular in nature. So, annular lesions and isoform lesions, both are conclusive of immune-generated immune diseases. Third is target lesions. Target lesions is somewhat like annular lesions, but and the central area will be hyperpigmented. Serpiginous lesions means it will be serpiginous. It will be like a snake. So it's not, it is uncommon. Although annular isoform target are very common. Got it? We are going to the next slide. See, my dear friends, these are pustules. As I have said, pustules are those eruptions over the superficial layer of skin which are above 3 millimeter in diameter. So you can say this is pustule, but when there is a diffused pustular area, we should say it is impetigo. So this is actually an impetigo. But individual lesion is known as a pustule. We say it is a pyoderma. Pustules, if pustules are there, it is pyoderma only. Got it? No doubt. Another pustule. So you can see the pustule, which is about 3 millimeter in size. Okay? Here you can see the pustules. Where the pustule, you can see the pustule. It's a pustule, 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 pustule. All these pustules are about 3 millimeters. As you can see, the erythematous inflammatory area around the pustule. See it clearly. All these cases you can see the erythematous inflammatory area. Okay, it's a superficial pustule. So pustule, what is the disease here? It's nothing but a pyoderma. But the lesion is primary lesion. The primary lesion is pustule. It is 100% pustule. But you can see hyperpigmented areas also can kill it. It's a papule. Papules are small, which are below 3 millimeter in diameter, which is again peripheral or superficial in nature. Okay, see, papule. Papules are very small, papular, small eruptions which contain pus inside. You can see the inflammatory zone around each papule. See the inflammatory zone, erythematous inflammatory zone around each papular reaction. So this is again pyoderma. Okay? Again, this is another papule. This is papule. You can see the erythematous inflammatory zone around the papule. So this is again pyoderma, where the primary lesion is a papule. Okay? Here is a vesicle. You can see the wall is so thin. The wall is so thin. And see, if you simply press it, it will break up and there is clear transudate inside. It's not exudate. There is a big difference between transudate and exudate. Transudate will be clear, watery in nature. Exudate will be white in nature. White or green, according to the nature of the etiological factor. For example, if it is Pseudomonas, Pseudomonas itself is known as the bacillus of green pus. So the pus will be green in color. So, okay, this is a vesicle. And now, the next slide. So this is another vesicle. You can see the vesicle here. This is a blister actually. These are blisters. This is a vesicle or a blister. This is a boil. Now we are going passing through the last set of slides. This is a boil. See, what is a boil? I have told it is an inflammatory superficial inflammation eruption which is encircling a hair root. Okay, it is not painful. That is very important. But a folliculitis is always painful. This is a folliculitis. It is painful. Okay, I'll clearly show. See, folliculitis generally are presented in our clinic like this. All our doctors might have seen this folliculitis in their lifetime, especially in Labradors, Dalmatians, and Dachshunds. This is a very common presentation. This is folliculitis. And now, this, see, when there are conjoined folliculitis, we say it is a furuncles. Or when there is conjoined furuncles, we say it is furunculosis. See, this is furuncles or furunculosis. This is an individual furuncle. This is an individual furuncle, and the whole lesion is a furunculosis. Got it? So it is bacterial infection. Furunculosis is generally produced due to Staphylococcus pseudintermedius. Okay, we will come to that tomorrow. Tomorrow we are going through pyoderma, etc. Okay. And now this is furunculosis. This is another type of furunculosis where furuncles are seen in between the digits. That is interdigital furunculosis. This is interdigital furunculosis. Okay. This is bullae, vesicles itself, but where the wall is very thick which contains serous fluid inside. And whenever you see a bulla, 100% of the cases will be immune diseases. So bullae, bulla pemphigoid, etc. will be the disease. Macula, I told you that. Suddenly occurring circumscribed black patches. Each macule is known as a macule. An extensive macule is known as a maculae or macula. Suggestive of pyometra in the female and cetrorhizal adenoma in the male. See, this is wheals. Suddenly occurring pruritic skin eruptions. Sometimes in our clinic, some patients will be admitted like this, where they say that this had been there for a week. Is it a wheal? No, it's not a wheal. It is the same lesion you can see in pyoderma also. Primary pyoderma. That I will come tomorrow. So it's a wheal. It's a nodule you can see. A large nodule. It's not a tumor. It's a large nodule which contains inspissated pus. Here you can see a small nodule. Here you can see a small nodule. Okay, all these contains lot of nodules there. So, these are pustular eruptions where the pus, the fluid portion of the pus is reabsorbed and our inspissated dry hard pus is there. Okay, it's a nodule. Flakes, epithelial denudation, where there is peeling of the epithelial tissue, there is flakes. If you see flakes, it could be Seborrhea oleosa and probably it could be Seborrhea oleosa and what infection? Yeast infection. Okay. Scales. This is a dry net. This is a scale, a severe scale due to this. What is it? This is Soroptis. Okay, this is Soroptis. And this is a soroptic mange producing scales. Okay. Go to the next slide. These are crusts. I told that flakes, crusts, and scales, they are brothers and sisters. Scales are dry in nature, but crusts are moist in nature. I told it. Crusts are moist in nature. You can see the crust here. Have you seen the crust? Dr. Ravindar Ji, Dr. Amaranath, I know you have seen it. Okay. So these are crusts. Then these are our epithelial collarettes, where I saw them. If you see epithelial collarette like this, it is invariably pyoderma and it is in the healing process of pyoderma. So this is epithelial collarette is a pathognomonic finding of pyoderma. Should we say bacterial pyoderma? No, we need not say, because pyoderma itself means bacterial skin infection. Okay, that is epithelial collarettes. And we can go through the tertiary lesions. This is hyperpigmentation. You can see the hyperpigmented area. See, you can see the hyperpigmented area. Completely hyperpigmented. And again, the big brother of hyperpigmentation, elephant skin, that is lichenification. Lichenification always shows the chronicity of hyperpigmentation. When you see lichenification and hyperpigmentation, it could be hormonal disorders or it could be infectious disorders like yeast or it could be other mycotic infections. We will come to that tomorrow. I am just showing you the primary, secondary, tertiary lesions, etc. Another case of lichenification where it is the skin will become wrinkled. That's a typicality of lichenification. Okay. Now, excoriation means all the five layers, the layers are intact, but the topmost layers will be peeled off. That is excoriation. Very typical to pyoderma. Excoriation. But in the ulcer, it will be deep and the complete skin layers will be lost. Thereby, a breach in the continuity of the skin will be produced. That is an ulcer. Okay, now we are coming to the last slide of this ulcer. Bharat Mata Ki Jai. Long live our nation.